'Tis many's a gay night, from dark till daylight, I spend with people of high renown. But in all their grandeur and heaps to squander, my heart would wander for sweet Omagh Town.
Hello again and a very warm welcome to you. You're listening to Sweet Omagh Town Internet Radio and I'm calling Declan Ford in Mountfield. Hello.
Hello.
Ah, you're there.
Do you know what? I was outside mowing the grass and I was, with all that pollen going about, you know, the song, Peggy Lee song, Fever, came into my head. You give me a fever.
Keep that for Sunday, will you now?
Hmm? That's what the summer does to me.
Hmm.
But I'll struggle through.
Gosh, well.
I hope you're well yourself.
Do you know I am, but I'm getting tired, Declan, you know.
You're getting tired? Well, it's not too overwork.
No, it's not. It's just lockdown. I don't know. I really don't know. I haven't listened to the news now since about, 14th of March, I suppose.
14th of March, right. Well, we're at war with Germany.
We could be. Because I hear enough on the internet and I hear enough on YouTube and stuff, but I don't listen to the news. And thankfully, from what other people tell me, I think it's a pantomime, isn't it, really?
Aye, and talking about a pantomime, that's a very nice introduction into what we're going to talk about today, I believe.
Yes, I've been going through old tapes again, and I found a tape that we recorded many years ago. I can't remember, Declan. Paddy Laird, the late Paddy Laird.
Oh,
and his memories of the pantomimes in the 50s and 60s.
A great man for the drama.
Wasn't he just?
The first play that I was implicated in was the Omagh Players production of Ladies in Retirement. I think the great Murray Martin was in it, Davy Fullerton, I think. And Paddy Laird, as far as I recollect, Paddy was the director, and he also did the makeup, and that was my introduction. And he actually took time to explain to me how grease paint was used.
There you are.
You know, and he shared his great knowledge very freely. And Lord, he was a very, very talented producer and director.
He was.
No, he was indeed. A stalwart of the Omagh Players, you know, in the days of the great Paddy Mossy. Mm-hmm. Do you remember Paddy?
Very well. Paddy was involved in the hospital radio with us in the early days, yeah.
Peter McGovern, of course.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And and of course, from that, the great Paddy McAlinney would have started his career, I presume, in the Omagh Players.
Yeah, that's the guy who went on to act in O Brother, isn't it?
That's right. He played one of the priests he was a very, very funny man. Great.
Yes.
Great talent, you know.
Were you about Omagh 1974, Declan? Remember when they recorded the Frank McCrory Songbook, by chance, no?
Right, no, I wasn't. I wasn't around when that was done.
You weren't born, obviously.
But I think it was, now I don't want to say you're wrong,
mm-hmm.
Heaven forfend, Mr. McGorgan, but I have a notion that was 1981.
Well, we'll agree to differ. I don't know.
Admit it, you're wrong. No, I actually came across, when you mentioned to me the other day that we were going to be featuring Paddy Laird, mm-hmm. and the Omagh Players, I hooked. You know the way you've got a tea chest full of records?
Uh-huh.
Well, I've got one full of books, and I came across a publication that the late Stephen McKenna gave to me,
mm-hmm.
and it is actually the songs of Frank McCrory, and in Stevie's introduction, he references a dozen or so were collected on a long playing record in 1981, performed by the cream of Omagh's entertainers, and I'd love to have been there.
Well, unless this is a typo, this record is an edited version of the concert commentary view held in the community centre on April the 14th, 1974, and the highlights of the evening has been put on this disc by Omagh Development Trust.
I'm wrong.
Both of us are probably wrong. Well, let the good people of Omagh decide, right? I say it's 1974, 14th of April, and if I am correct, please give us a little flag up. If Mr. Ford's correct, a little flag down.
Yes, but Please, somebody out there,
put us out of our
tell
misery.
Me, I'm right. Let me have one over McGorgon, for goodness.
one of
well,
few.
Well, anyway.
Okay. Anyway, I think we'll be...
Sure, that's as it is.
It is.
But it's a rarity now. I mean, firstly, a long playing record. Who out there in the great beyond would know what a long playing record was?
Well, it took me a day and a half to find it, right?
Right.
A day and a half to get the turntable, to find a stylus to fit the turntable to play it on. And another half a day to get it transferred onto a computer and uploaded. But we have done it. And it is as it is. It's a bit crackly for a 1974 album, not 1981, 1974. But it's reminiscent of that. And I say there's some nice wee parodies and things in it. And my favourite is Catching Minnows in Kitty Lahore Born by the late Peter McGovern. Lovely.
Oh, yeah, that was one of Stevie's party pieces.
Wasn't it just I?
And I remember when the extension for the Brothers was opened in the early 1990s, I put together a show, and I wanted to feature music from each kind of decade or generation from the school was established in 1860 or 61. And to cover that, a certain period, I wanted... when you and I were young, Maggie, you know, the old song, I think, from the 1890s.
Mm-hmm.
And lo and behold, we came across a recording, I think, of a very young Dominic Kerwin singing Frank McCrory's version of When You and I Were Young, Maggie.
Well,
the words that we used. It was Frank McCrory's version, but he changed the lines to suit...
Yes.
The locality in Omagh.
He did the one on this album is the late Michael Gormley and Kathleen Given.
Right.
And he does a nice version of The Bell of Arvilly instead of The Isle of Innisfree. That's putting our little townland on the map for us, yeah.
Oh, yes.
In the bog.
So no doubt after this, you'll be singing away to your heart's
content. As I walk down the road whistling, is right. Okay. Tom Sweeney's on this album
dear,
as well.
But he also had a great song in the, you know, it's amazing the way that history is recorded. He has a song called The Old and the Skill in Line. Now, I'm not sure if it's on the LP.
No, I don't see it here. No.
He just talks about the end of the railways and just goes, you know, just sort of checklists, stops along the way.
Yes.
And, you know, a wee bit like the recordings we're doing, you know, it is a kind of a social history. And I'd say Frank McCrory was writing it as entertainment. But like a lot of the best entertainment, it actually taught you something, maybe something about a kind of the history of the place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so really looking forward to hearing the LP.
Yeah, from my memory, the late Paddy Laird talked about he and his girlfriend at the time, who later became his wife, went to Dublin to see a pantomime, and his late wife told him that if Omagh Players can't do better than that, then they shouldn't be called the Omagh Players.
Right.
And that actually started it off. I got given the nucleus to go back and write something. And to say the rest is history, because it was very, very successful. My late mother used to say it was the biggest highlight of the year was to get to the pantomime. And,
Derry. I seem to recollect Paddy talking about, I think, buses coming down from Derry.
Yes.
You know, to see the pantos.
Yes.
And I suppose that they had their time. And then, do you remember Stevie then resurrected the pantos with the Omagh Theatre Workshop?
Mm. That's right, you
and
know.
Then latterly, I think the council have been involved in having an annual pantomime, which is great. You know, it's a great form of entertainment.
Yes. Jonathan and I were at that this year's panto, and it was superb in the Street Arts Centre, right? Really, really good. Yeah, very entertaining, you know. I must say now. Let's say it's good banter with it, and good houses as well. So that legacy lives on, Declan, doesn't it, really, in a lot of people?
Oh, yeah. You know, and... the pantos, there's a sort of an innocence about them and a sort of a knowingness as well, you know, and if you get a good dame that can kind of feed off the audience, you know, you suspend your belief for a while in reality and you just accept what is on the stage as a new reality, you know, and I suppose you can get away with a lot of things too. And I remember some of the old timers and the old players would talk to me about various japes and wheezes, especially the backstage crew would get up to. You know, I think there was one instance, I think, where there was pirates. And, of course, they were yo-ho-ho and a bottle of rum. But I think on the last night, some wit or wag nailed down one of the tankards. So when the pirate went in a fish tanker. He lifted up the entire table, knocking everything over.
Yeah, well, I suppose as the overture and the start always says, now is the time to banish all cares, and I suppose this, you know, this is what Pantomime done in Omagh, really, isn't it?
That's right. Mm-hmm. I just, as you say, just enter into this world.
Indeed.
You know, and well, I think, you know, today's broadcast should certainly bring back a lot of memories.
Hopefully it does, and good memories at that. Unfortunately, it's a bit short interview. It's not the complete interview that we done with Paddy Laird, because unfortunately we had issues over the tape that day. The second tape is actually recorded on a different machine, so we're not able to upload it, but we have about 15 or 20 minutes of Paddy in full flight. And then we will put on the Frank McCrory Songbook for people to remember and sing along with the likes of the late Peter McGovern and various people like that as well.
Oh, for goodness sake.
I think George Rogers was the compere that night.
Really?
Mm-hmm, from memory.
Right. And I remember George, he was very involved in the Omagh Players, and they had a great troupe.
They really had a good
troupe of a backstage crew as well, you know.
Absolutely,
everybody pulled well together.
Oh, yes. So, without further ado, Declan, we'll let you back to the landscaping, and we'll enjoy the next hour or so in the company of the late Paddy Laird and the Frank McCrory Songbook.
I look forward to that, Donald. Here, great talking to you.
And you.
All the best.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Tell me, Paddy, about your involvement in Omagh and your memories of Omagh and how Omagh has changed over the years.
Well, I mean, for a man of my age, Omagh must have changed. I mean, it had to change, whether we like it or not, really. Whenever I was growing up as a young fella, I mean, whenever I started, in those days I started the Convent National School, and then when it came to seven, then you were transferred over to the Christian Brothers, and you were educated from there on, and you thought to yourself, what you'd make of it at the time. But, no, there are many changes. I mean, this town has grown enormously from size, and for a town, you know, there is no obvious means of support, and so far as it's not a commercialised area, there's only the two factories.
Well, your early days were spent then in the Convent Primary and then the Christian Brothers.
Well, that was the usual procedure then anyway. It didn't matter how from where you came, you always went to the Convent Primary School first. As a matter of fact, there's a well-known lady in Omagh at the moment, Nora Tourney, who came to the school when I was in the class at the convent. She was, she came from Derry, and Nora, her name will come to me again, but she arrived at the same time. Nora's still going strong.
Can you remember any of the brothers in the primary?
Oh, I do. I remember Brother Hamill very well, who, you know, I mean, I think Brother Hamill was renowned. He was well known by everybody, you know. The way Brother Hamill, if you did wrong, the way Brother Hamill, it was always the stick on the bottom. And I remember another Christian brother called Walker. He was known as Baldy Walker. And then whenever I went over to the secondary, I remember the two books. Fatty Burke and Thin Burke. There were two brother Burkes in the school at the same time, and Tony Shun was teaching then. Tony has since passed away as well, but those were happy days with them.
What were conditions like in both the primary and the secondary school?
Ah, well, they were completely. I mean, when you went to the secondary, it was grind all the way. If you didn't grind for yourself, I mean, well, I mean, there was no end product. Whereas in the primary, you were transferred to the brothers anyway, no matter of what standard you were, whether you were intelligent or like me, sort of half middling. But you were talking about asking me there where was I born.
Uh-huh.
Well, I'm living on here on the Tamlet Road, and about a half a mile up the road is where I was born. So I'm actually back to where my own birth roots. I was born in my grandfather's house, Barney McKinney. He worked in the railway at the time. He was one of these men in those days that a uniformed man was held in very high esteem. But he was also a clockmaker, believe it or not. And he kept budgies. And he had one of the oldest gramophones in this area. the, you know, the ones with a cylindrical record.
Back cylinder.
Just like a tumbler, like a cylinder. And he had well over 200 gramophone records then, well tabulated and indexed, and two massive big horns for it. And
were these of singers or was it music?
All types of music in those days. It was one of the original Edison gramophones. In those days, and that's going back 60 years ago, he was offered £200 by the BBC at that time, when radio was in its infancy. He was offered £200 plus a brand new oak cabinet radio. But he refused it. I don't know what happened since.
Did he play music himself then at all?
No, he didn't. I don't think he played music himself, but the house never emptied with musicians. Artie McGlynn's father, Jimmy McGlynn, you know the famous Artie McGlynn? Artie McGlynn's father used to come and play the melodeon, as it was then, the accordion as opposed to now. But they used to come every night, and there would be seldom a week would go past without some musicians of some sort coming to the house.
Was it a great Killian house then?
Well, not, I wouldn't say it was a great Killian house. It was a house where you were. Well, then I would say it was the same in all country houses at the time. You walked through the door, the latch was always on the door, and you could walk in and always be welcomed in it. He was one of these. I think he was a self-taught man. He used to grow orange lilies for the orange men for the 12th of July, and they used to all come and get their orange lilies before they came into the town to do their parading. So there was no such thing as the problems that we have now. It was most ecumenical in there. When I was telling you about being in charge of the Christmas display, actually I thought that in those days I thought that was an honour, because as a youngster I used to go down with my nose pressed up against J.B. Anderson's window to see this massive 8 foot tall figure of Santa Claus, and it was clockwork, and the head went backwards and forwards, nodding, and we used to say, we used to be told, if Santa Claus is nodding his head, if you're good, Santa Claus will be nodding his head when you're watching, and that means you're going to get their presents. And to see this huge big figure for the first time, you know, I was intrigued with that. And, you know, I thought it was a great honour to be able to help and assist in getting this all together. And that this clockwork, Hornby clockwork crane, and it went round the I'm sure that the window at the corner of the Dublin Road must have been at least 30 foot wide and, you know, 12 or 15 feet deep. And this went in, and it was decorated with little stations and houses and little miniature cows, you know, or cattle and all around through the fields, and then all the toys were interspersed around it as well. But that was the Santa Claus then. Nowadays there's Santa Clauses in every second job.
Well, who actually put up the display? You know, who owned the train set? Was that Anderson?
That of course the original one was. And some it broke down one year, and there was a bank manager in the town called Gearin. Once the bank had son, he had a massive one in the bank, and he had the skirting board cut. He used to go from one room to the other, and the Andersons borrowed it from him, and he used to be down and he would look after it. But it used to attract an awful lot of attention in those days. Was and then we had a post box for youngsters to put their letters in, and I used to have to read all these letters, you see. But this man Cathcart, he was a gruff character, but a man with a heart of gold. But I remember reading one letter from a young girl. She was about 12, I think. and she wrote in, "Dear Santa," she wrote something like, "Dear Santa, would you please bring a door for my little sister," and whatever Jade's name was, "and a train, a small train or whatever it was, for my brother. Mama is sick and I don't want anything for myself, and just bring these." And Mr. Cathcart said to me, he says, "Get whatever is there that these children want," he says, "and get out and deliver that for them." You know, I thought, I'd always remember him for that.
Were Andersons an Omagh family?
No. Oh, well, the Omagh connection's around 6 mile across, but they were actually from Bournemouth. I think it was Bournemouth. The people who actually owned those premises. But Mr. Cathcart, he was Omagh. His son John then took over, and Howard Cathcart is still alive. I think he worked for the Western Health and Social Services Board, the DNF, Howard. And both he and John were terrific table tennis players. And as doubles, they got all the prizes that were ever going for. They were terrific table tennis players.
Well, then you mentioned then the Omagh Players, and you met Paddy Bogues through the Omagh Players.
Yeah.
Could you tell me about how you got involved with the Players?
Well, whenever I was younger, before I went under the Omagh Players, I used to do compared all the concerts. Matter of fact, that little book I was showing you is way back 1940. But anyway, I was in, and there was a friend of mine, Frank Ball. He invited me in, and he and I used to do a double act at all these concerts. And he invited me in, and that was October 1944.
As a matter of interest, what was the double act? What did it consist of?
Well, I was always a comedy compere, and then he would do the interruptions, and he was the foil, but he was a good character actor for the Omagh Players, a tremendous man, and he brought drama to most of the rural areas around here, Drumquin. I think he brought it to Castledare. Introduced it to Castledare, and they introduced it to 6 mile Cross, Berra, anyway. But he was a man that, you know, that was keen, very keen on drama, but always kept in the background, never looked for the limelight at all. Very quiet and assuming man.
Well, did he have a drama troupe then that would play us on in these various smaller rooms?
No, he went out and produced. He initiated the drama in these areas, and then he would go out and produce it for them.
And give them a start.
And then that it got going.
Well, can you remember any of the plays that he would have put on?
Oh, God, now you're talking.
George
Seals. Oh, mostly the usual, in those days, the kitchen comedies, you know, George Seals plays, certainly. The names that, I would need to have looked up some of the old records and some of the old programs of a lot of the old. I wouldn't have any programs for him because they would have been done outside the town. So, because I have a lot of old programs from all the Omagh Players shows.
Well, can you remember what was the first Omagh Players production that you were involved in?
Oh, that I was involved in? I was involved in Boyd's Shop, but that wasn't the first. The first one under Paddy Bowes, I think, was called Laburnum Grove. How Paddy Bowes became involved, the Omagh Players was founded by a man called Francis Joseph Nugent. He was a local man from a very well-to-do, certainly in the sense that there were a highly respected family in the town. He was an insurance man, and he started it in 1934. And then he was transferred to Enniskin in 1941. But in the meantime, Paddy had come from Belfast, and he had been interested in drama in Belfast. So then he came in when FJ left, and he took over from then. And I think that first play of his was Laburnum Grove. I went in 3 years afterwards. And they were casting for Boyd's Shop, and that was the first time that Kathleen Given, she joined the same time as me. And Kathleen and I were chosen for the play. And I was in it, and unfortunately I had to withdraw. They went into the festival, had to withdraw because my father was dying at the time. My father wasn't well, father was ill. And Jacqueline went on. So the festival circuit was in operation then as well?
That was
not to the same extent or the same degree as it is now. When the Omagh Player, there was a festival, even in Francis Joseph Nugent's time, the one at Dundalk and the one at Enniskillen, but that would be the best of maybe of five or six clubs. And the Boyd Shop one at the Father Matthew Hall, the Fish, in 1945. But nowadays, you've got to get through five or six festivals with five or six teams. So five sixes are 30 teams. If you're in the festivals now, you've got to be the best of five or six to get forward, now. The competition's heavier now, it's keener now, and the whole standard is so much higher,
Were there any other drama troupes in Omagh when you joined the players?
Not at that time, not at that particular time, but shortly afterwards there was a troupe started at the First Omagh Presbyterian Church called the Omagh Amateur Theatrical Society. And they used to be known by their abbreviated name, Oats, the Oats. And they did a tremendous job. They were excellent. They had some of the best settings you'd ever see in any stage.
And where did they put all their plays?
Oh, in the Town Hall. Oh, in the Town Hall as well.
Well, how many plays were the players doing a year?
Well, roughly two, no more than two.
Panto?
Well, the Pantos didn't start, until 1950. And actually, they started by accident. And it was through Frank Ball and I. And that's what actually started it. I was married in 1948. And my wife, who was working in Dublin at that time, I used to go to see the pantomimes in Dublin. And when we got married, the first year we were married, 1948, we went to Belfast to see this professional panto, I think it was the Empire, and it was unbelievably bad. There were all these professionals who, if a double act did their double act and just interspersed it with some lines out of the script, but it wasn't good at all. When we say it wasn't good, it wouldn't have taken in a country town at the time like Omagh. They were good in their own way. But I remember my wife saying to me, she says, well, if the Omagh Players couldn't do better than that, you wouldn't call yourselves players at all. And she set me thinking, and actually I give her credit for starting. So I said to Frank Ball, Frank, I'm going to write a script for Cinderella. And you and I would be the two ugly sisters. So it was a question of being big-headed and writing a part for ourselves. But it was a tremendous success. The first year, I think it went for 13 nights. And when we finished, it was going for 23 performances, over 3 weeks. And then I wrote all the scripts. And I directed them all but two. But that's still been going. But it got too heavy for me, especially with the business and family.
Well, then what about songs within the panto? Would the songs be written specially with an open audience in mind?
No, the parodies would be. All the funny stories, they were written by the late and the great Frank McCrory. In actual fact, there's a book of Frank's songs. He wrote the famous Treacherous Waves of Loch Muck for the band concert, St. Eugene's Band. But All the other songs were pop songs or the popular songs of the day. So if there was a duet, they sang that. But the parodies were left to the comedy players, like Ball and myself were the two ugly sisters. So there was a song for us, Then when Paddy Mossy came in, and Mickey Gormley, and Dickie Kennedy, and Jackie Kennedy, there would be a concerted number, you know. There'd be four singing this, and there'd always be something to do with the town hall, the shape of the town hall, and it was in desperate state in those days. Hard seats, or the council, the councillors always got a touch, or somebody always got a touch in it, and Frank McCrory actually was a genius. He was a genius for that sort of thing. All you had to do was tell him, write it out the way you wanted it, and Frank would put it into verse.
And was he musical director then of the
at that time? And himself and Martin Myler, and then Brian Torbett took over then after that as musical director. But Frank, he would write and rehearse all the soloists and the duettists and all as well. Oh, he was a tremendous help.
Where did all the rehearsals take place? Were they in the Minor Town Hall?
No. We were supposed to be... In those days, it was a parochial pantomime. And we were supposed to be rehearsing in the hall behind the church. And then the boys and girls clubs, they had started, and they were using it for boxing practice and for other singing practices and all. So then we used the Foresters Hall and the old Liver Hall in the Kevlin Road there. And that's where we did all the rehearsing. But it was a huge success. We counted 8 buses from the state one night, you know, that come from. You're too young, don't remember that. There was no shortage of help and assistance from all the traders in the town. Now, Scott's Mill, one of the biggest manufacturing people for meal, they gave us anything we ever wanted. I'd written a scene for the Dick Whittington, no, Robinson Crusoe, and where they were shipwrecked. Robinson Crusoe, where they were shipwrecked, and we needed a big tarpaulin for the stage, you see, because we had a bit of a slapstick on it as well, you see, and this big tarpaulin came, and anything we wanted, Scott's Mill provided anything we wanted, and so did all the other traders around the town, because they were bringing a lot of people in at night as well. All the cafes were bound out at night afterwards, and it was a good time in those days, you know.
I think you remember that tune very well. It was opening chorus of the Pantomimes in the 50s.
And yes, I remember
it. As far as I know, it was an original composition too.
It wasn't written for the Pantomime. It was written years before for the St. Eugene's Band.
Mm.
And I wrote it for, we called it the Joe Hackett's Foxtrot.
Why?
And poor Joe Hackett is gone. Mm. It's One Step. Joe Hackett's One Step.
Mm.
And I also had written another wee one, which was in the Pantomime 2, Pat Givens Foxtrot.
Mm.
They were both members of the band, and they were young at the time.
Yeah.
And Then when this thing, when they came to me to write the music for the first pantomime in 1950, they wanted something nice and lively. Well, I thought of this wee one step, and it didn't take me long to stick the words on it, and there you are, the thing was right.
It was certainly a very catchy
tune. I think it was played at every pantomime from 1950 to 1960.
Well, Joe Fess is telling me it was played for 13 pantomimes. He should know.
Oh, well, of course, I said there was 11 and the two there by Austin Lynch wrote the music for that, fixed the music.
Yeah. Well, fortunately, I know you've preserved a lot of your stuff, and tonight we'll take a trip down memory lane and revise some of the songs in paradise. The night may be tedious to Omagh people to list all of your talents, but at the risk of embarrassing you, I have to tell the uninitiated here that you, Frank McCrory, have in your lifetime been a singer, a musician, conductor, arranger, tutor, parodist, balladist, etc., etc., etc. And your work has been fantastic. And
George,
I think
my hat will never fit me after that.
Well, anyway, happily we have Peter still with us, and as chirpy as ever. And he's now going to sing the first comic song of the night, Catching Minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn.
Wee Johnny's came from school one day, his mother got to know. When he came home that evening, boys, but he got tally-ho. She whacked him hard as she cried out, "Why were you boy all day?" Between his sobs the neighbors heard wee Johnny softly say, "Catching minnows in the Killy Clapper Burn, catching minnows in the Killy Clapper Burn, oh catching minnows in the Killy Clapper Burn, oh what a happy time." An Omagh lady to her doctor said, "I'm going to die. My nerves will never be the same, no matter what I try." The doctor says, "You'll be all right if you'll do what I say. Just get a wee glass Kamchat, dear, and use it every day." Catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, oh, all a happy time. A Mountfield man, age 99, is looking for a wife. He's never had a holiday or been sick in his life. He has a great big farm of land and wants to marry soon. When married with the bride, he plans to spend the honeymoon. Catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, oh catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, oh what a happy time. Cried an Omagh teacher, "Such a stupid class I've never met. Your ignorance is shocking, not a single boy I'll bet. Can even tell me where was Moses when the lights went out?" To his surprise, the class stood up and answered with one shout, "Catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, oh catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, oh catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, oh what a happy time." After the Battle of the Boyne, they say King James was caught, and in his rags and bare feet to King William he was brought. King William says, "Now where were you? I thought that you were dead." King James held up his wee glass jar, and to King Billy said, "I was catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, catching minnows in the Killy Clatter Burn, oh what a happy time." This world's an awful sinful place, no decency at all, with such temptations all around, a man is sure to fall. If any of you listening would heaven was like to climb, just stop a wee bit, dump down jars, and spend your whole spare time catching minnows in the killing of the burn. Oh, catching minnows in the killing of the burn. Oh, catching minnows in the killing of the burn. Oh,
stuff altogether. Looking through your book, Frank, the odd thing about it is that there are lots of songs there and a lot of serious songs, and I honestly never heard one of them sung. You know, the song there, I think we'll sing it next, Lovely Struil Valley.
Oh, no, that's not so very old. I don't think that was ever, we ever did it. We did it on a tape right now. Mm. We did a tape when Margaret, my daughter, was away in America. There was Jimmy Torbett sang the bass. I harmonized the choruses, and Peter sang the melodies, and I sang the tenor part. Well, we did that, and we sent a copy to, I think it was a copy taken to the Philippines, Father Bennett, and then there was one sent to young Reverend Brother Donnelly away in Assam in India. Mm-hmm. But
well, it got around, didn't we? I've never heard it, actually, and it's only just looking through the book that Gertie has there that I even saw it for the first time. But I think there's no harm in having old Lovely Struil Valley.
Lovely Struil Valley, I liked it very well myself, to tell the truth. But
Tom Hunt, or Tom Sweeney, rather. What sing it for?
Is Tom there?
I was thinking of Tom of the band.
In dreams I stand once more upon the slopes of Bessie Bell, and gaze upon the lovely scene, a scene I know so well. A valley lies before me, a vale of beauty rare. Oh, what I'd give if only I could once again be there. Oh, lovely Struil Valley, majestic and grand, no valley more fair can be found in the land. The Struil gliding gently, the proud Bessie Bell. Deserted there, I see green island in the Struil gleam like an emerald rare. From merry grey to dark grange wood, I know each hill and dell. How dear that sweet vale is to me, no words can ever tell. Oh, love. Majestic and grand, no valley more fair can be found in the land. The Struil gliding gently, the proud Bessie Bell. Oh, lovely Struil Valley, my heart's in your spell. Far distant is the dark outside.
line of Gordon's rugged ridge. Beneath me o'er the shining silver sprue stands Black Rock Bridge. In Carrigan, the old mill that I knew stands in decay. Oh, heaven grant I'll see again that lovely scene someday. Oh, lovely Sprue Valley, majestic and grand, no valley more fair can be found in the land. The Sprue gliding gently, with proud Bessie Bell. Oh, lovely Sprue Valley, my heart's in your spell.
We're talking about that song now. If the thing that I like about the reason that I wrote these songs all about Tyrone was everybody was singing about the Mississippi, the Missouri, Pasadena, and God knows where in America. And I said, why should we be singing songs about America? Or why should we? Why not sit down and we could write as good of songs ourselves? So that's what I did. And nearly all the songs I wrote about. And I'm not writing about any place that I don't know about, because I did all these places on the bicycle. I went around everywhere, and I did. I was up in the Sperrin Mountains. I don't know how many times. I was at the top of Mullaghcairn, both ways up this way and way around Drumlay. I did all those on the bicycle, and that's why I think I'm running about the date 77.
Well, I remember you made me offer time and time again to go to Mullaghcairn, but I always refused. I sent me Sherpa instead.
Well, there's another thing about now. You have the song there, the Hills of Donegal. It used to be a famous song.
Yeah.
Mary McHugh, Mrs. McCluskey used to sing it very well. Well, there's not one mention of any place in Donegal. It could be away in Manchester or somewhere for all the word that if you read it over. There's not one mention. It could have been, I don't know who wrote it, I don't remember now, but it could have been written by some Jew man in New York.
Now, there's the Hills of Donegal.
The Hills of Donegal.
Good
you'd think it was an Irish song, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Well, there's not one mention of Airgill or Muckish or any mountain at all in Donegal. Nor any place else in Donegal. And I said, well, if I ever write a song about Tyrone, by golly, I'll mention them. And that's why you have all these places mentioned. It shows that I was round it.
But I often thought too, talking about the band, Frank, you know, in your young days there, it was, I'm sure, before the days of buses and all that. Had you ever engagements outside the town, or did you just confine your activities to the town, like parochial sports in the town, or did you ever get away anywhere?
Oh, we did. We got away. We were in Finton.
What? We got further.
We went further. We were in Crana and we were in Temple. Oh, we were in a whole lot of places.
Well, they just get back safe.
We always got back safe. Oh, aye, no, Lord, aye.
Well, it'll take a whole night, Frank, to talk about the band, and I'm sure you have many an anecdote about it, so have I too. But it would really take too long, and you'd need another program for that. But I know many people don't know that you have also been a scriptwriter in your time. And you wrote the scripts for sketches that were performed at band concerts. And I remember you wrote such epics as The Audition and The Emperor in Glenhorgia.
The Emperor in Glenhorgia, I remember. Yes,
at least I remember those two, anyway.
Right.
And the cast, like, were all just members of the band.
That's right.
They even played the female parts. I actually remember playing Mrs. Doyle opposite Charlie Doherty. he was Mr. Doyle. I'm positive too that it was in the Emperor Glenhorgia that one of the comic items was the treacherous ways of Loch Muck.
Oh, that's
I think it was, wasn't it?
Well, Charlie Doherty and John McFadden, God rest John, sang this, this song, like, I think verse about 6 verses in it. And Charlie sang it very well. But I haven't heard Charlie, that's a terrible long time ago, and I haven't heard Charlie Doherty singing since. Mm. And his voice must be marvellous now, it's so well preserved.
You don't know what it's costing him to preserve it, too.
Me and Andy one evening were strolling as the sun was beginning to set, and went just outside Drumride New Graveyard, a young Lochmuck sailor we met. He brought us along to his liner that was resting the lake like a duck, and that's how I started our ill-fated cruise. I'm a catcher of waves of the brook.
All together now.
And that's how we started our ill-fated cruise. I'm a catcher of waves of the brook.
As our ship glided over the water, we all gazed on the landscapes we knew. First we passed Clannabogan's big lighthouse, then the pigeon top faded from view. But alas, as we sped over those waters, soon we were with her a dumb throat. For without any warning, a big storm arose on the treacherous waves of Lochmuck.
Without any warning, a big storm arose on the treacherous waves of Lochmuck.
The storm came on with thunder and lightning, and the big waves lashed mountainous high. Our ship was tossed hiller and tiller, and black darkness came over the sky. The passengers shrieked out in horror as her ship a cut all us right struck. Me and Andy was all that was saved from the wreck on the treacherous waves of the Lochmuck.
Me and Andy was all that was saved from the wreck on the treacherous waves of the Lochmuck.
People talk of the great Loch Ness Monster, and I can see it from young and old. But the monsters we saw in that evening leave the Loch Ness boy out in the cold. Sure, sea lions, whales, alligators, with mouses like a truck. Oh, the sights that we saw as we waited for death on the treacherous waves of Lochmuck. Oh,
the sights that we saw as we waited for death on the treacherous waves of Lochmuck.
There we were, like two Robinson Crusoes, miles away from Faria or Chow. Though we starved for a week or a fortnight, not a ship ever came within call. At last we decided to swim it, though we don't like to brag of our pluck.
Master, we on the treacherous waves of Lochmuck.
And after swimming 2 days, we reached Craven Bay
on the treacherous waves of Lochmuck.
There we lay on the beach quite exhausted, till a man with a big dog drew near. He shouted out, hey, clear away out of that, for if I want no drunk, oh me boys here. He said we've been drinking and sleeping since the clock in this parlour 4 struck. And that was the end of our ill-fated cruise on the treacherous wave of Lochmuck.
I remember anyway, there was a Kelly scene in it, and there was a song I thought was quite a good one. As a matter of fact, it was the only serious song that I ever heard, I think, sung.
That was John McCracken.
John McCracken song.
Glenn Horgan.
Well,
have you any music for it, Kelly? Well, in memory of John McCracken, I'll sing it myself.
Here. Frank, I think there that some of your parodies, or most of your parodies actually, they were too complimentary to the local council or to the members of parliament or that type of thing, but of course they're always good for a laugh. But I remember an old one of long ago was The Big Potholes of Omagh. But in that book there I came across another, a real oldie, that is Omagh's Electric Light.
Oh, yes.
That's a lot. I don't know how far back that one goes, really. But since it might never be sung again, anyway, I asked Mickey Gormley, and he has volunteered to sing it.
Good, that's like an electric delight to get.
Did you hear the news that's going round? They're going to bring electric light to dear old Omagh town. Oil lamps and gas are out of date. We want our town made bright. We must be modern and install the new electric light. Mick Lynch and Davy Clements were the two that did the trick. As politicians, they are foes. As friends, they're very quick. The opposition did their best to put the two to flight. But with orange and green united, Omagh got the electric light. Things didn't go too smoothly, and the critics scoffed with glee. And the roof above the powerhouse cracked very dangerously. But Spalding and his able men worked hard both day and night, so that Christmas 1930 would see Omagh's electric light. The urban council keeps the streets in very poor repair. The potholes and loose surface stones would drive you to despair. The councillors can't see the faults, they think the street's all right. But I'm sure they'd see the potholes when we get the electric light. Yes, I'm sure they'll see the potholes when we get the electric light.
Talk about the question time reminds me that Dr. Mann was here at the time. And he came over to me, I was playing for Peter. Peter, by the way, Peter sang Bella from Omagh at all.
That's what I hoped you'd say, because I did ask him to sing.
That is where Bella made her debut, in the St. Mary's Hall.
Yeah.
But I was going to tell you, but Dr. Mann came over to me when I was sitting at the piano, he came over and says, hey, would you mind coming in, he says, into this quiz?
Yeah.
And I says, not at all, what is it for? To see it's Irish history.
Mm.
Well, I said, okay, I'll go over. And he said, I'm not very good at Irish history, but I did it at school, of course. Well, anyway, I went over, and it was the teachers and somebody else, and I was on the other crowd.
Mm.
You see, the teachers, of course...
The teachers,
you know,
are the smart people.
The teachers are the people that know everything. Well, I didn't know a terrible lot about Irish history, but I read a good deal after I left school.
Yeah.
And I remember the first question I got was, what was the name of the place where the Williamite Ordinance was blown up by Sarsfield?
Yeah.
Well, I remember that because one of the boys made a poem about it, and he says, that was a neat job they did at Ballymeade. You see?
Yeah.
And I that came back in my memory, and I said, right, it was Ballymeade. Mm. That was good. And the next round. And the next one was about the holding the bridge at Athlone, it was Sergeant Costume.
Mm.
And I remembered it also. I don't know how I remembered it, but I remembered it because the name was very English, I thought,
for
a man to be holding the bridge at Athlone against the Redcoats.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I got through that too. And I don't remember now what was the... I was going on here and they were all dropping out.
Yeah, yeah.
And to my amazement, I was going on and finally, I and another man were left together.
Yeah.
Here we were. So, the question he asked the other man first. Now he said, "I'm going to read a speech, and I want you to tell me who made it, when was it made, and finish it." So the speech was out. He gave him the speech, and he said, "Now, can you tell me who made it and all that?" And the man didn't know. And Dr. Mann turned to me and he said, "Now that's not your question, but can you answer it?" And I said, "I can." Well, the speech was made by Robert Emmett, and it was made in the dark, and I finished it.
Yeah.
And how did I finish it? Now this is a very strange thing. When I was a wee lad of 3 or 4 or 5, I used to toddle up to Ned Phillips, the blacksmith, who lived in Castle Street, where Gormley's shop is now.
Yeah.
And he had a big picture of Robert Emmett on the brace, you see, the fireplace.
Yeah.
It used to be very common, a lot of people had them. And underneath was the speech.
Yeah.
And old Ned used to read me out the speech, and used to say the speech, you know, great time. Mm. And eventually I got the speech off.
Mm.
And here it was put on the plate for me. And it all came back to me, I don't know how many years, it all came back to me, and I was able to finish it. And not only that, but I got the best name in the town for being the great historian. why I say that was my young daughter, the eldest girl, was at school the following day, and she overheard one of the teachers telling the Reverend Mother, whoever was in charge in the room, that Mr. McCrory was a genius.
Well, just as your brother-in-law, Frank Ben Kelly, keeps Omagh on the map, so you've immortalized all the little town lands around the town here, and song and parody. And then flipping through the book, I came across a parody entitled simply, I think it's The Bell of Arvalee, is that right? I'm not too sure. I think it's The Bell of Arvalee.
Yes.
I think it's, looking at the music, I think it's there of Innisfree, isn't it?
Yeah, that's yeah. Right there. That, the Innisfree was very popular. Was it a picture or something?
Did Bing Crosby sing
quiet
it?
Man. That?
Quiet
Man.
Oh, the Quiet Man, that's right.
Oh, the Quiet Man, right. Well, that's, yeah. It was in Innisfree then, was very common, everybody was humming it. So Innisfree just suggested Arvalee to me.
Okay. Nothing could be more obvious.
So then I sat down and wrote the poem. I don't remember a word about it. Is he going to sing it?
Well, I anyway think it is sung to the air of Innisfree.
Yeah, that's right.
And if you want a song sung to an air, no better man can do it than Paddy Massey.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
The loneliest year song that ever I heard sung was Corradina. It honestly is. I never heard any year serious songs been sung at all. And I remember you sung it one night to me up in your house long ago when we were copying out music. And that's the last I heard of it for years. But I know I have a vague memory of hearing it at a concert, and it was sung by a soprano.
Mary McHugh, or Mrs. McCusker.
And it couldn't possibly have been anybody else but Mary McHugh, now yes, Mrs. McCusker. So, unfortunately, we have on Mrs. McHugh, or Mrs. McCusker here tonight. But Tom Sweeney has volunteered to do his best with it. Carter Bennett.
There is a spot most cherished in my memory, where perfect peace is always to be found, where nature reigns in rugged mountain grandeur, and not disturbs the silence so profound. Oh, when my soul with life is tired and weary, and troubles seem to press me on all sides, I think of long forgotten Corradina, where peace, a peace not of this world abides. The air is crystal clear on Corradina, the sweet scent of the heather everywhere. The hallowed rock stands moss grown and forgotten. 'Twas here in days of your folks met in prayer. What memories surge around me as I ponder, and though my heart with care oppressed may be, I'd gladly take my cares and proudly bear them. Inspired, O Corradina rock, by thee.
Well, Frank, as you said yourself, you're a great sentimentalist. I think an incurable sentimentalist. You loved as every civilized man should, the mountains and the glens and the streams and the lakes of the surrounding countryside. You loved those nostalgic songs about the lost summers of youth and the rosy tints of old memories. But I'm sure you pulled out all the stops when you wrote your words to when you and I were young, Maggie. And to sing it, we'll have Kathleen Given and Michael Gormley.
I wander today to the hill, Maggie, to view the town below. The river and Arnold Old Mill, Maggie, as we used to do long ago.
The trees are red on the hill, Jamie, and all its new houses was fair.
Arnold Old Mill is in there, Maggie,
McGovern in mind, you know, because as I look through your book there and read some of the songs, I can hear in my head Peter McGovern's voice belting them out, you know.
That's true.
I suppose he was the man that inspired most of them, really.
That's right.
Well, I couldn't think of anybody better than Peter anyway to sing the next song, and that's Peggy the Pride of the Plum.
I was cycling from Garchin one wet April day. I was making for Granite, some 9 miles away. I was getting on grand when Bab says to my luck, in a big briar bush my front wheel got stuck. I perched the old bike to a wee house white deer. As I neared it, I saw a wee collie appear. She smiled so divinely and looked oh so sweet, that I blessed that old briar bush that caused me to meet. Peggy, 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 the bride of the plum. How I love you, your blue eyes shine like the bright stars above you, my neatest, sweetest, darling bride soon to become. With our love true and strong, life will be one sweet song, Peggy, the bride of the plum. Next evening I pass by that wee house once more, and Peggy, so lovely, was there at the door. She smilingly met me, and then hand in hand, we strolled through the farmer's gap, rugged and grand. There deep in the spellings, our love we confess, and though with this word's good, I'm not over-blessed. But I know I'm the richest man now in Tyrone, for that priceless wee jewel I said she's my own. Peggy, oh Peggy, Peggy the bride of the plum. How I love you, your blue eyes shine like the bright stars above you, my neatest. And sweet, darling bride soon to be come. With our love true and strong, life will be one sweet song, Peggy, the bride of the plum.
Well, we couldn't end on a better note, I think, than one of Frank's own. And I have asked him to rattle off the final chorus of the Pantomimes so long ago. It was his own composition. It's the Panto Finale chorus, and we're all going to gather round and belt it out.
And will you take the top G?
No!
Soon the book of many lights, oh,